trauma theory has been around a lot lately in film studies, yeah. And it's in many cases it's been misapplied. But in the case of Lav Diaz's work, I think it's you know, a completely straightforward response to the type of movies that he makes, movies that are actually about trauma. So maybe this is a good place to start to just give you some background on where Lav Diaz is coming from, but also give you some background on the precise reason why trauma is such an important concept in his cinema. But before we do that, and I shut up and I let Nadin talk, we're going to show you a very short, well, you know, according to Lav standards, a very short clip from his most explicitly meta-cinematic, meta-textual film, A Century of Birthing, a film about his own creative crisis. And in this clip from the filmmaker character, supposedly a stand-in for Lav himself, although they differ quite a lot, I think, the filmmaker character is interviewed and is asked about his conception of cinema. What is cinema for him?
Now let's go back to the moving image.
Yes. The moving image. It's too simplistic now to see cinema that way. That was cinema as we know it. Mm-hmm. The moving image. Charlie Chaplin's 18 frames per second. The majestic 26 frames per second. The normal 24 frames per second. 60 frames per second. The slow-mo. The 22 frames per second to suggest speed. The tracking shot. The pan. The tilt up. The close up. Medium shot. Full shot. Crane shot. The zoom. The full coverage. Fucking full coverage shot. Well, cinema is beyond that now. Malayo na. Malayo na sa Regal, sa Viva, sa Star Cinema Ship. Malayo na sa Hollywood, sa Hong Kong. Malayo na ang cinema. Or am I saying this because I really don't know anything about this medium? Or I am as ignorant and as stupid as the sheeple who eat noontime and primetime television? Well, or baka I am as idiotic. The fucking Metro Manila Film Festival. Fuck that festival. What is cinema? Mamamatay akong hindi ko masasagot ang mga tanong na yan. Pero sigurado ako, tol. We will remember the world because of cinema.
We will remember the world because of cinema.
Yes. I am sure of that. We can recreate, reenact our memories through cinema. Can even reinvent our memories. Cinema will go back to the past, the present, the future, now. cinema will bring us to the past, the present, the future.
Wow.
Now.
That's fate.
Pretentious.
Hindi ba? Sinagot mo tanong ni Martin Heidegger.
Being?
Artist being.
Cinema is being. Ano ba lalabas yung document?
This is a funny scene. So the question would be, to what extent is this an accurate self-portrait? Is the filmmaker in this movie about a filmmaker in crisis? It's about a lot of other things, but it's also about that film that he made while he was struggling with...
to finish Florentina, what was to become Florentina Rubaldo CTE, which he then finished a year later.
Right.
So this, I find it to be quite accurate. I find it interesting that he actually mentioned regal films at the beginning, you know, that cinema is beyond regal films, because he himself made films for regal, for the regal studio. I think he made 3 or 4 films. But yeah, he himself is now beyond it as well. And I mean, with Bartan West Side, he has really started to move into a much different kind of cinema. I find it to be an accurate description of himself, yes.
But at the same time, is there sort of a self-mockery also? Because they're talking about his art being, well, the filmmaker's art being qualified as pretentious, and the fact that he's thinking about cinema as pretentious in itself. What I find really striking about Lav Diaz is when you see him in interviews or in public events, he's a very modest guy, he's an intellectual, but at the same time he wants to come across as a very modest, everyday guy, a bum from Manila, that kind of.
Yep.
But at the same time, he reads philosophy, and so how does this give an image of the filmmaker as filmmaker, not just in terms of a philosophy of cinema, but just as, how he presents himself as either an intellectual or just a regular guy, an instinctive filmmaker, is what I'm getting at.
I think, to be honest, in that scene, I think he compiles the views he gets from outside about his cinema, about his filmmaking. It is not just his own position about his cinema, about himself as a personality, but also about the critiques he gets, even, he's pretentious, his art is pretentious. I think he has, in that scene, really compiled what people think about his films. So it's a complex thing, you know, what you consider is his own point of view, and then I think he infused it with the point of view of others.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a straightforward scene, it's certainly double-edged.
Does it matter at all that, you know, to me it seems like a reference to the type of films that Godard was making in the 60s especially, and he's, you know, said himself that he's a huge Godard fan. The fact that it's almost filtered through a Godardian perspective on, you know, the interview inside the fiction film, does that make any difference to the way we're gonna get something out of this scene? That it's already at a second level, so to speak. It's a play, of course, it's autobiographical, but to what extent? And then again, it's filtered through this convention that we associate with another filmmaker.
But that's what we talked about before, who's got these references.
Right.
You know, I think those people who are not familiar with Godard, the scene will not make any difference if, you know, they will just see it as a Lav Diaz sort of scene.
Mm-hmm.
For those with who are familiar with Godard, mm-hmm. I think it's quite interesting because Lav Diaz himself never references Godard as such in interviews.
Uh-huh.
So, I don't know, it's I find it to be, there's a tension,
mm-hmm.
so to speak. So, yeah.
That's something that we can talk about maybe later, because that's something that, to me, we're coming at this from,
yeah.
from different perspectives,
yeah.
of course. Your PhD is an inquiry into really the relationship of Lav Diaz's cinema to the spectator,
yeah.
and not just the representation of trauma, but the traumatic experience in a way of the films themselves, and how they can serve as a kind of an almost therapeutic medium for people afflicted with trauma or recognition.
Yeah,
he certainly puts
character and viewer on the same level. He tries to anyway.
Right.
Yeah.
That's again something that we'll take up in
yeah.
in a minute.
Yeah.
But in this clip, it seems like it's a clear anti-statement. It's a kind of a reckoning with the Manila Metro Film Festival.
Yeah.
I don't know. that's a commercial film festival then, because
I think was that not the one that was set up initially by Imelda Marcos?
Yeah.
Initially,
yeah.
So of course you can see the
absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
So is there obviously, if you look at his first mature movies that are recognizably his,
yeah.
that are recognizably Lav Diaz films, and we'll talk about his style in a
yeah.
minute. But is it a clean break? I mean, he did quite a lot of films, commercial films, before he started as an art
yeah.
film maker. Is there anything you would say that he's taken away from those commercial experiences, other than kind of a basic technical expertise or something? Because, you know, ethically, ideologically, you get why he would want to disassociate himself from that tradition. But is there anything in the popular cinema of the Philippines, and what is the popular cinema of the Philippines, that he would take away for his own work?
Well, the popular Philippine cinema is pretty much, it's very similar to Hollywood. It's pretty much the same stories. They've got a star system, the studio system, everything is pretty much the same in the Philippines as well. And I think what Lav Diaz has taken away from it is actually everything that for him doesn't work. I mean, he himself says that he embraced the period because he learned how not to make films on his own. He learned to work with a big crew. But he found himself that actually, you know, it's easier to work with a smaller crew. He originally learned to get a full script and then start filming. He's not doing that any longer because he's learned that this kind of this puts limits on his filmmaking.
Mm-hmm.
So I think there we are talking about, in a sense, about absence again and negativity, because he's taking the popular cinema. Yes, he has learned a lot about it, but he's turning it upside down in order to make his own cinema.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's what it is.
And what about the melodrama aspect to his films? Because many of the few Filipino commercial films that I know, including those of Lino Brocka, are very melodramatic. Melodrama is a hugely popular genre in Asian cinema in general. Is that something, you know, that's kind of remained in his films? Because at a certain level, you could say that, although of course they're, you know, massively long and they're distanced, and they're obviously dealing with more important stuff than generic melodramatic
yeah.
situations, but there's always this melodramatic element in them. For them to affect us as viewers, especially a film like Florentina Hubaldo. It's, you know, it's a transformed melodrama, you could say.
I've never seen the films as melodramas, actually.
Yeah.
That's quite interesting. What makes it melodramatic for you?
Well, the fact that despite the distance, the emotions come through really effectively. And I get the sense that throughout the film, he's kind of working towards getting closer to the characters, right? And setting up these situations that he knows will set off an emotional reaction in the viewer.
But the aesthetics are different.
The aesthetics are completely different, of course.
He's certainly not using close-ups to show emotion.
No, not to that extent. Yeah. But still the idea of a melodramatic structure that you have this catharsis at the end, and his films are very carefully, well, again, up to a certain extent,
yeah.
But his films are very carefully structured in that way that we were talking about this stuff earlier, and one thing that we agreed upon was that it always pays to sit through a Lav Diaz film because the latter part of the film, so let's say the last 2 hours, completely validate the 6 or 7 hours before them. So even if you don't like the first 6 hours, stick with it, because these 6 hours will get completely transformed by that final part. And that's where the bigger emotions come in, and where characters are more precisely drawn, and everything that you've seen in the first part starts to make sense.
That's actually quite interesting, because we speak about his films as being slow.
Yeah.
But you know, I find that after the first 2 or 3 hours, which I know sounds funny, but then I find that it actually speeds up, because you get so many clues about the narrative of how the characters are linked together and what the background is. Everything then comes boom, boom, boom.
Mm.
It's slow booms, but nevertheless, they're booms.
They're booms, yeah.
It really is the case that, I found Melancholia, for example, that was my very first Lav Diaz film.
Mm.
The first 2 hours, I thought, wow, okay, when is something happening? Then it really came. He's taking his time to unravel it, to unravel the narrative. And this is what I argued in my thesis, for example, with the theme of trauma and melancholia, death in the land of encantos and Florentina. It's not boom, you're traumatized, but usually it takes a while before the first symptoms of post-trauma appear. And this is exactly what he's doing with the length of his films. He's just taking his time to evaluate and investigate the psyche of the characters.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the reason, Nadin, why I mentioned melodrama and already start hammering on the fact of narrative construction is that I have an agenda, obviously, and the agenda is that I want to get rid of the idea of Lav Diaz as an observational filmmaker who makes films in which nothing else happens but time passing. You know, there's a sense in certain reviews that I've heard of his films by critics who clearly are not that informed, that his cinema is artless, that all he does is, you know, puts his camera there and observes life and looks at people. And this is a complete misrepresentation, I think, and it's important to realize that, in the light of making you want to go out and actually see those films. A complete misrepresentation because, to me, they are both at the same time, and that's their incredible power, that they manage to be at once observational and really ground in reality, but at the same time, very carefully narratively structured, working as melodramas with rounded characters. That makes sense, and they're actually appeal to our emotions with a lot of content, the kind of content that we'll talk about in a minute, artistically controlled, and so the absolute opposite of artless, I would say. So that's important, I think, to point out already at this
point. I think that's where the distinction between fact and fiction comes in as well, which we do have with Death and Land of Encantos.
Yeah.
I don't know when we want to show the extract, but that's where...
Yeah, let's do that.
That's where it really comes through, because... Death in the Land, I don't know, shall I?
Yeah, maybe you should set this up, yeah.
Death in the Land of Encantos is a 9-hour film from 2007. And it was originally meant to be a documentary about the aftermath of Typhoon Durian, I think, there were so many. The setting was just completely gone, so he felt personally affected by it. So after this apocalypse, which you can see in the film, he went out because he felt he needed to do something. So he just went out and filmed the aftermath of the typhoon. And he wanted to make a documentary, a kind of news footage, whatever. He just wanted to record something and send it to whoever, CNN, BBC, whoever. But he then decided to create a fictional narrative around this in order to create an homage to the people who died there. I think over 1,000 people died. They were buried alive. Hamin is a persecuted poet artist. He's persecuted by the Philippine government for writing critical poetry, for inciting revolutions. And on the right there with the hat is his friend Teo. He also used to be an artist, but he has stopped, even though Lav Diaz never really explains why that is the case. And Hamin has just returned from 7 years in Russia in order to bury his lover who died in that disaster.
Naman ako makakwento sa'yo kasi tahimik ang buhay ko doon.
Amin pa paano maghintay yun dito? O Prague, Berlin, Moscow, London, Warsaw.
Sa Russia ako nakatira. Sa isang dibdib na book doon. Kaluga ang pangalan. Wala akong ginagawa doon kundi maglakad ng maglakad. Turo sa university. Kumuha ng litrato, mag-video.
Busy. Sabi nila, ang artist daw na malagi sa isang lugar, kapunto sa isang lugar, nag-iiwan ng mga tradendat, anis, pakalit, nahala-ala.
No. Konsepto lang yan ng isang romanticista.
You're an artist, pare. Ang sabi nga nila, ang artist must suffer alone.
Wow. Kaso mga hindi ako romanticista eh. Nagkataon lang na yung pangumuhay ko mag-isa. Desisyon yun, pare.
Uy!
Minahilan.
Sa magandang diskurso niyan. At pangati ng diskurso sa antas ng teorya. Ako namin, matagal na akong inaliwas sa sirkulo dito. Wala na rin ako sa student support. Utan, lahat gusto maging national artist. National artist na wala namang ginawa sa kultura. Pare, nasan ang forma nila ngayon? Isang libo pa. Hindi lang bukis. Isang libo.
I mean, the most striking aspect of this scene, I think, is the fact that we get a lot of exposition. We learn a lot about the characters and their relationship, and story-wise, it's set up in this scene, so it's not just observing. It's only done in a roundabout way. He doesn't really immediately go to the core of things, but he lets them talk, and then gradually this information comes in.
But you don't know that, you don't learn that much about the characters.
Right.
I mean, that scene, I think, is 20 minutes into the film,
mm-hmm.
and we still don't know much about Amin. I mean, we know that he spent 7 years in Kaluga, in Russia,
mm-hmm.
and that he was teaching there. But that's all about it.
It's a weird choice, don't you think? Russia. Why Russia? He spent some time abroad as a generic concept. Why not Europe? Why not America? Why Russia?
Do you want to know the reason behind it? Because I asked him.
you can ask him.
No. I asked him about his choice of Kaluga,
uh-huh.
because Kaluga, that was quite interesting, because Kaluga was a famous place of exile for
uh-huh.
persecuted artists in Russia. So I asked him, you know, where does that fit in? Because he obviously portrays the persecuted poet artist.
Uh-huh.
And he didn't know about the importance of Kaluga. Kaluga is in there because he was invited to a film festival there. So
well, that's a lucky fluke.
He was looking through some footage, and he then found, oh, Kaluga. I was in Kaluga. I still have footage there, because he always goes somewhere with his film camera. He just thought, just put it in. It
mm-hmm.
makes perfect sense for that. Yeah.
The other thing is, of course, the quality of the sound, right?
Mm-hmm.
The whole idea of Lav Diaz being an art de pauvre filmmaker, which he is, of course, but doesn't mean the same as being an artless filmmaker. And
no,
of course, the sound quality is the result of the limited technical capabilities that he has on his shoots. But maybe you could tell us a little bit more about how he sets up his shoots. He works with a limited group of actors that appear in film after film.
He does, and these actors and actresses usually do several jobs at once. They're also crew, part of the crew. So he sees film shooting as a kind of way of teaching the people
mm-hmm.
as well. For example, he appears in, from what is before, Lyric de la Cruz.
Mm-hmm.
He has now made his own short film, his first short film, and that was screened in Locarno, and was selected for the short film competition.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something Lav Diaz is really interested in, to teach his actors and actresses also how to make films, so that if they're interested in it, go out and make films themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And he always asks the same people, as you said, because he knows what he gets there, and they're just friends. He describes them as a family.
Mm-hmm.
So
another thing that can come up later on when we look at the clip from Florentino Baldo is of course how wonderful these actors are. Again, something that gets forgotten in the whole discussion about arte povera and slow cinema is that these films are so reliant on performance and the kind of wonderful performances that he gets. Whether or not they're in long shot, it's still a good performance.
Of course. Otherwise, without these actors and actresses, the films wouldn't be the same.
Absolutely. So, but he does set up his shots himself. He's his own cinematographer.
He
shoots them on digital video, obviously.
Now, yes,
yeah.
He used to use analog, but I think he switched to digital in 2010, 11 or something around that, because he finds it cheaper, much
mm-hmm.
cheaper and much easier, and he also finds it easy now to, because you can edit in while shooting in the end, it's so much easier. If the shot didn't work, then you can just delete it.
Give him that aspect of his work, the fact that it's most of his important films were shot on DV.
Yeah.
As a filmmaker working in this long take idiom, how then to decide how long a shot should be? This is again, Godard's big question. The most important question in filmmaking is, when to end the shot. And I guess that applies doubly when you're working in an extremely flexible medium like
digital.
Yeah. So how does he time his shots? How does he decide, how long they should be? Is he interested in rhythm?
It's mainly instinct for him.
Mm.
He sets up the camera and you can't say that the film rolls, but he starts shooting.
Mm.
And obviously he lets the narrative unfold, the action unfold, and then whenever it feels right to him, what
mm-hmm.
is it? It's exactly what Simon Young said as well. When it feels right, I cut.
Mm-hmm.
So that's exactly how he works. He told me that sometimes he even knows before he starts shooting how long the scene should be. But again, this is just instinct. This is really just a feeling,
mm-hmm.
a gut feeling. It just feels right.
Mm-hmm.
He can't really say, I count, another 2 minutes and then I cut. That's not something he does.
Mm-hmm.
As I told you before, he does that at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
At the beginning of a shot, he tells his actors and actresses to count until 10, or until 20, 30, before they should say something or do something. But that's only for the beginning of the shot. For the
end. Is that to allow the audience to get a sense of the place and the environment and the mood before they start focusing on the dialogue and the faces and the people?
Perhaps, but it's also for the actors and actresses to really feel into their role first.
Right.
Because, he does not want them to act just like that.
Mm-hmm.
Because he doesn't think this is very natural. As for the end of the shot, when to cut, it's completely instinctual.
Yeah. Do you have any idea whether or not he changes his cutting patterns? Whether he decides during the shoot that the scene should be 2 minutes and then, he shoots perhaps various takes of it, and then after a certain time he decides that, no, it's going to be only 1 minute, or does he have...
For the same scene?
For the same scene, yeah. Does he have a definite schedule, definite setup in mind before he starts cutting?
He doesn't go with any setups to any film shooting. It's just, whatever comes up during the film shoot.
And is that something that he tells people, or is that actually the case? When you talk to people of his crew or his actors?
You would actually have to be with him in order to see whether he's telling you the truth or not.
Yeah.
I've last year when I was in Locarno, I met him and his crew. I met Perry Dizon, who is the artist with the hat.
Mm-hmm.
I met him and I met Hazel Bomancio, and they all said the same thing, because they explained to me how Lav Diaz is really approaching filmmaking, and how they're not really asked to act, but to be in front of the character, in front of the camera.
Mm-hmm.
They're meant to be the character.
So. Does he rehearse at all?
Sorry?
Does he rehearse at all? Or?
Not that I know.
How many takes in general, or just the one? one take?
I think usually it's just one.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it's just... I know that we talked about it before.
Yeah, no, just...
No,
again,
the word,
there's an agenda, of course.
The word organic.
And it, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Because Lav Diaz always describes his filmmaking as organic.
Right.
That means he just lets it flow. He does...
Yeah.
He says that he does not take a lot of control over it, but actually,
yeah.
You know, that obviously there is control. But,
Because those are actually the two versions, and I kind of want to complement the idea of the organic, instinctive, go with the flow type filmmaker with a more control. I don't want to make him out to be a filmmaker that he's not, but I think, I mean, Ho Xiao-Xian is exactly the same way. If you talk to Ho Xiao-Xian, he was here a couple of months ago, he will tell you the same thing. Oh, you know, just mise-en-scène, yes, very important, but let's go have a beer and... you know, the old John Ford type story, that filmmaker style to critics. How did you do that shot, Master? Well, I just, you know, put the camera there and shot it, and, you know, then we went off to lunch. And they don't really want to get into the specifics of how they set up a shot or how they think about style. And when I look at Lav Diaz's shots, for me, the attraction is at least double, of course. There's the tremendous emotional impact and you know, the actual... content of his films, obviously, that we'll talk about, but also the fact that very many of his shots, not all of them, it's hit or miss, but very many of his shots are absolutely beautiful, breathtaking, and the camera is in exactly the right space, in exactly the right position where it should be, and this is a talent that I think the best either contemporary or classical filmmakers have. They have this talent to know where the camera should be, and sometimes they take a lot of time to come up with this perfect place. Sometimes it's an immediate instinctive thing, but especially in this type of cinema, it's of course crucially important because it decides, you know, the vantage point on the entire scene and what we're going to take away from it. And here in this, you know, I'm inclined to call this a composition, and it almost sounds perverse given the subject matter and given the fact that we're looking at the devastation. But I want to get your thoughts on that, on to what extent you consider this to be a controlled frame, a balanced frame that he thinks about a lot. And just as something that I might want to bring up as a point of comparison. And then he lets, you know, the animals and the person with the animals, COVID or whatever, vacate the frame. And almost exactly at that moment, the car appears. And then that has happened, so we get part two of the shot. And then, you know, something needs to happen in the foreground because the shot is still going on and the cattle herd has disappeared. So, and this, you can see this in the making of the film, actually has an assistant director throw in this rooster as a shot filler.
But I think this is more to the...
But if you...
To keep the audience engaged.
Yeah, maybe.
So that you always have something happening, because usually what you see in Lav's films, for example, or in any... slow films at the moment, is that you don't have these animals or anything. You really just have dead time.
Yeah.
You don't see anything. No movement whatsoever. You just have a static shot and nothing is happening.
Uh-huh.
So I find this actually quite different from Encantos.
Yeah.
Because there's still something happening in
well,
that
narrative
scene.
Is happening there. But if you ask anyone who's watching that film, okay, it's in color, etc., but it's still the same setup. It's a distant... camera perspective, there's action going on in different layers of the shot, same thing in Lav Diaz's shots, and it's at the same time it's controlled and it seems completely open and found.
I don't think you've got different actions on different layers in Encantos.
Not in Encantos, but say in, well, very often he has in these cafe scenes. Where, you know, the gaze tends to wander. You're looking at these people talking, but at the same time, there's something interesting going on in the background as well. In Melancholia, for instance.
I think it was Melancholia,
It's not in that shot, obviously. We only have the one center of attention.
Yeah.
But still, I'm wondering about the fact whether or not the moment when the dog appears, whether that's controlled in any way. You know, whether that's something that he adds at that given point in the shot. As a sort of, no matter how small it is, or no matter how insignificant it is, it's just an element that he adds to again, maintain our attention or make the shot more pleasing or add a certain dynamic or a certain movement in the shot.
I can't say for sure about this particular shot. I would say that the dog was just there and used it. And it's one of those really nice coincidences that a dog ran through the shot. But I know from Florentina Hubaldo, for example, where Florentina is kind of in a trance-like state at night in the streets, and you've got the people walking past and the cars driving past. That is not controlled whatsoever. Even the people who are walking past, that's not controlled. He literally just set up the camera, filmed Florentina, and whatever the people did in the background, that was their thing. And I know that that's an anecdote, actually, because the people who walked past, they actually didn't see the camera, because Lav Diaz was filming, I think he was in a hallway or something, and was filming Florentina from that. And the people in the streets actually found Hazel's performance so real that they actually asked whether they could help her and stuff, you know. So so at least for that film, I can be sure that it's not controlled. And I think that's
But it didn't go so far as to use that then, the moment when people came up to her and asked her if she was okay.
He did not use that, no.
Because
it didn't fit the narrative in a way.
Of course, yeah.
Okay, so if you see it like this, it's controlled, if you cut that,
What about sound? Because in the scene in Florentina that you mentioned, of course, it's open in the sense that it's filmed on the street with real people, real setting, real vibe going on. But still, it's worked upon in the sense that he takes away the sound. It's a silent shot. And it's filmed with a long lens, obviously, since he's shooting on the street. So a lot of the shot is out of focus, which gives it, in combination with the lights that are shining directly at the camera, gives it a kind of a dreamlike, trance-like feel to
it. Just like the state Florentina is in.
That's
exactly what I mean, that he's really using his aesthetics to transmit what the character is going through. So that,
almost in an expressionist way.
Yeah, exactly, because that's something he always stresses in interviews, that he really wants the viewer to struggle just as his characters struggle.
Okay.
So, yeah.
How does sound contribute to that effect, that the viewer feels what the...
The interesting thing is, I think that Florentina was the first film where he really experimented with sound to such an extent. Usually we have ambient sounds, you know, just nature. That's what he usually uses. Florentina was the first film where he, for the first time, took away the sound, which is really traumatic for the viewer, actually. And then he juxtaposes it with acoustic stress, where you've got the giants and... I've got the giants on...
Yeah, shall we take a look at it?
Thinking.
Yeah, sure. So this is a clip from Florentina Rubaldo.
It's... Another six, it's a 6-hour film, it's one of his shorter films. And you closed my folder, Tom.
I'm sorry.
And Florentina is a metaphorical tale of 4 centuries of colonialism, and then followed by Ferdinand Marcos's dictatorship, which Lav Diaz described at the Edinburgh International Film Festival in 2012. As a repeated bashing of the head against the wall, because when the Spanish arrived in the Philippines, they obviously enforced their culture onto the natives. Then it was the Americans, the Japanese, then the Americans again, and then it was the dictatorship, obviously.
Yeah.
But it completely illustrates what we were saying about the expressionism.
Yep.
The fact that what we see expresses what the character is going through. So the first time you see this scene in the film, it's hard to make any sense of it because you don't know what the relationship between the shots is, and the sound actually illustrates that.
That makes no sense at all. I mean, the first time I saw the film was in 2012, and I went through a lot of shocks actually, because he constantly alters absolute silence and acoustic stress, just like what we saw.
Mm-hmm.
And because you ask about the importance and the role of sound, as for that film, he wrote a lot about trauma, because this is his most explicit film about trauma, the trauma of colonialism, the trauma of the dictatorship of President Marcos. And he writes a lot about trauma in combination with silence, what silence means for trauma victims, for trauma survivors. And he just noticed how frightening silence is for trauma survivors.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why he put it in, that's why he played so much with sound in that film.
Mm-hmm.
He just really wanted to give the viewer a sense of what Florentina is going through.
Mm-hmm. So in a way, these images that after a certain while we understand to be a kind of a comfort to her, a kind of a memory from, I don't know if I should give this away, but it kind of contrasts with what you're saying about silence being scary. It's in a very similar way, in his films you have the presence of the woods, or nature itself, really, as both a comforting environment and a scary environment. And you have that with this scene as well.
Yep.
It's both, in a way, it's kind of unheimlich or scary, and still it's her comfort zone.
It's
where she goes to.
Yep. And it's also the comfort zone for the viewer.
Yeah.
Until Lav Diaz wakes us up with
yeah.
heavy rain, for example. Or usually he juxtaposes scenes of absolute silence with...
Mm-hmm.
Scenes of the Gigantes parade with the giants,
yeah.
with really loud brass music
yeah.
And drums. So yeah, we think we are safe.
The
viewer thinks he's safe, but actually, you know, Lav Diaz just doesn't give us that respite. He just wakes us up.
Maybe just as a continuation of this, maybe we can show the clip from
Melancholia. I just want to say something about the woods. They're certainly not the kind of fairy tale woods we know from our childhood. And this is because Lav Diaz grew up in the middle of nowhere. His parents moved from the city, from Manila, to Mindanao, which is basically just woods and mountains. They moved there to teach the poor. So that's where he grew up. And he describes himself as a forest guy. But he also knows that he has learned that the forest can be very dangerous, and this is exactly the kind of forest he's portraying in his films. So Melancholia is an 8-hour film, divided into three parts from 2008, and it's a film about the disappearances in the Philippines and about the resistance fights in the mountains. So here's an extract from the third part of the film. Thank you.
Mahal ko ang Alberta. Kumara na sana niya ng pagdurito. Pansamantalang naantala ang pagtulis nila sa amin. Sa pagkataon din makapagpahiya kami ng kaunti. Wala nang kapiyasa ng lahat. Nakaamba na ang kamatay. Kahit bukas, sa makalawa. Nakahanda na kami. Mamamatay ka na yung lumalabang. Sa ganitong kalagayan ay napakaraming naglalaro sa akin si Bakit labis ang kahangala? Bakit labis ang kalagutan sa mundo nito? Ang kaligayahan ba ay isa lamang konsepto? Ang buhay ba ay isa lamang proseso upang masukat ang habis ng tao? Makikita pa ba tayo? Hindi ako natatakot sa pamamayan. Kasi kung natakot ko, hindi na kita makikita ng iyo.
It's almost perverse to say that the kind of landscape and the rain that was created because of the typhoon in that region of the Philippines.
Melancholia?
In Encantos. And in the later films, yeah. Is like the ideal landscape for his type of cinema, of course. Because it rains all the time and it's a devastating landscape.
For his new film, which he just finished shooting, he was disappointed that he didn't have enough rain.
Yeah, okay.
So it just looked too optimistic.
Right. But it is a very cinematic element, and also here, of course, in terms of sound, and that's another reason, I guess, why you put up the clip. If you take away a lot of the expressive possibilities that you have as a filmmaker, a lot of the stylistic possibilities that you have as a filmmaker, no camera movement or hardly any camera movement, only these couple of handheld shots, take away color, take away, you know, a lot of the expressive toolkit that you have, then what you're left with becomes doubly important, which is, of course, framing and acting and sound.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I think we really get a perfect example of what sound can mean to creating the kind of immersive environments that he's looking for here in
this
clip.
Yeah. Yeah. It's always the rain, yeah, just like in Tarkovsky.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
There's
yeah.
this element of water.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would like you to talk a little bit about the trauma aspect of these films, because taken together, Encantos, Death in the Land of Encantos, Melancholia, and Florentina Ubaldo seem to be Lav's trauma trilogy. It's not that he makes...
I see it as...
Or you see it
trilogy,
as...
Yeah.
It's already become accepted knowledge.
No. He usually doesn't talk about trilogies, apart from his martial law trilogy, which he finished it with... from what is before, and once he finished that film, he realized, oh, I've got a trilogy, but he's not intentionally doing that.
But what does trauma mean for him, and what does it mean for you, and how does trauma allow him to set up these allegories of Filipino history that he's dealing with?
What does trauma mean for him? Actually, I can put that slide up. Well, trauma means a lot to him, because he's in effect translating his own trauma from the Marcos dictatorship into his films, which you can see most strongly in Florentina. And in an interview, for example, he described what he experienced during martial law. And he says, I've seen people breaking down, begging for their lives, losing their minds. I've experienced being hit with an armalite rifle's butt and then hitting the ground gasping for air. Our barrio was attacked and bombed by fighter planes, and decimated bodies were flying all over. I saw Muslim bodies, young and old, pregnant women and babies, being piled up near highway after massacre, the house turned into ashes in the background. I saw tortured and burned bodies of Christians after massacre, the house is still burning in the background. So all that was something he witnessed while growing up during martial law. And for him, when I ask him what filmmaking means to him, because, I mean, I was working on these three films and it was very obvious that these films were about trauma. I asked him what filmmaking means to him, and he said, for one, it's a cleansing process, personally. And this cleansing process adjusts to my culture, to my people. We need to confront all these things, all the traumas, all these unexamined parts of our history, of our struggle, so that we can move forward. It's a kind of cure. I always want to tell stories about these struggles. Personally, I want to cure myself of the trauma of my people. But I guess also of his own traumas. I know that he keeps speaking about he had polio when he was younger, and he was completely paralyzed. And that frightened him. That really frightened him, and that traumatized him as well. And even nowadays, he's still frightened that at some point in his life, he may not be able to move his limbs anymore. So even that kind of fear is in his films. His experience in martial law, especially.
Does the idea of trauma comes through in his films, of course, as the idea of, you know, the past returning and coming back and kind of blending in with the present and the future in his definition of cinema also?
It's the past seeping into the present,
yeah.
Because, I mean, his films are never just about the past. They're also an investigation of the present situation in society. And his films basically show that the Philippines have not yet moved forward, even though colonialism has come to an end and the dictatorship was replaced by, at least on paper, by a democratic leadership. You still have disappearances, extrajudicial killings, so actually nothing has really changed for him. And yeah, his films really are about past and present. Not so much about the future, which is interesting, because he could easily use his films to maybe make a comment about how society could be, but he doesn't do that. He really focuses on past and present.
Could you see it in a dialectical sense, maybe, in a Brechtian sense almost, that, you know, history teaches us that the present situation is not something that is absolutely given but can be changed, you know, stressing the contingency of history in a way.
I guess so, yeah, of course.
But also from an aesthetic point of view, which is again what you were dealing with in your thesis, you deal with an aesthetics of duration, and we see plenty of examples of that, but you also deal with an aesthetics, what you call an aesthetics of absence.
Yeah.
So how does absence relate to trauma, and is absence something that is part of his mise-en-scene as well, not only thematically making films about, you know, the disappeared persons, but basically as an element in the mise-en-scene, showing and not showing?
Yeah, of course, absence is a major force actually in his mise-en-scene. For example, in Melancholia, you don't see the military who's hunting the three fighters. Any kind of enemy is in the off. You don't see anything. And that's particularly interesting for Florentina, because Florentina has the repeated rape of Florentina at its center, but you don't see any of it. You can hear it, but you can't see it. And this absence actually stems from something that is called virtual blindness, because during a traumatic event, all senses shut down, especially the vision, and then the brain just can't record what's happening. So this is called virtual blindness, and I argue in my thesis that this is what Diaz translates in his film, the absence, the virtual blindness, that you can't see the traumatic event.
Okay. Something that I've also been wondering about is, and I guess his use of off-screen space is related to that, the idea of a roundabout movement, not dealing with things straight on or explicitly, but sort of coming up with structures or forms that allow you to think this through without actually addressing it. I'm sounding really vague now, but what I mean basically is that I find it really striking that he makes political films, but his political films are basically political allegories. He comes up with these concepts, like the idea of rape, the rape of the continent becomes a rape of a person in Florentina. The idea of disappearance, the idea of birth, all these concepts that he comes up with to talk about the condition of his country and the history of his country.
But for Florentina, you have to mention that it's actually a double-edged sword, because it's not just the rape of a country, it really is also the rape of a young woman.
Of course,
because, the story behind Florentina is a friend of his moved from Manila to... I'm not sure where it was, in the middle of nowhere, and that friend of his was approached by poor men who wanted to sell their daughters for 50 pesos, which would have given them, I think, 1 kilogram of rice or something like that. So it's really happening in the country, and Florentina that's why it's a double-edged sword.
Yeah.
But he's using that exactly as an allegory of...
And again, that's his strength, it's always the two together. It's
exactly.
Both open and controlled, it's both,
at
the same time, allegory and very particular and very concrete.
You have to be open as a viewer, and you have to be investigative as well.
Yeah. So he starts from anecdote. He has this story that he wants to tell, something, a real piece of information that someone has given him, and he has, of course, this relation to actual documentary material, since he himself is a documentary filmmaker to a certain extent. There are, he uses found footage in his films, or he uses scenes that look like found footage in Melancholia, for instance. There's a scene where they find the bodies of some of the people who disappeared.
Yeah.
And it's staged completely as a kind of a found footage scene, and it's very particular about the place where these bodies were found and who these people were, etc. So the idea of testimony comes, it is always there.
There's a fictional element in that.
But there is a fictional element.
Because you've got
Ho
Young.
Yeah,
in that
of course,
scene.
The characters are in the scene. So
that,
there's always
that
tension between.
Fiction, that's really interesting with his filmmaking.
Yeah. So, but he starts from anecdote. And then he starts thinking about ways in which he can transform that anecdote and make it into a film, make it into a story with characters, etc. And one of the things that I find hugely fascinating about his work is the way he does that and his frame of reference. this is a story that actually happened to people within the society that he knows, where he lives, the political, social history of the Philippines. But then the way he starts telling that story is through the perspective of 19th century literature. Mm-hmm. Because in many of his films, the way the narrative is structured and the characters are defined and even some of the situations in dialogue is straight out of Dostoevsky, whom he loves. And, you know, it's not just Dostoevsky, but it's Emile Zola, etc. So, in a way, again, there's this doubleness, you know, of a filmmaker tied to his own locale and his own culture and country. And on the other hand, there's this almost, you know, global intellectual who's devouring all these different literatures and using those very almost traditional literary forms to tell his story. So
he calls himself a Malay filmmaker. He wants to make Malay cinema.
That's right.
So what exactly is Malay cinema?
Yeah.
I mean, for him, it's mainly about the long storytelling.
Yeah.
And the duration, the really long duration, because it's.
But how do you rhyme these two aspects to his personality? On the one hand, someone who is dead set on being a local, you know, very place-bound filmmaker, making films about these people at this moment in time, and then on the other hand, fabricating allegories that derive, to an important extent, from 19th century Russian literature.
But you know, I never thought about that, actually. I mean, Nota was the first film where I definitely saw Dostoevsky in it, but that was the first and only film I saw it.
Uh-huh.
Now that you mention it, yes, of course, it makes sense, but of course there is a tension. But I think it's part of his whole filmmaking anyway. It's like he's making these films about local history, local story, but his films are not seen in his own country.
Mm-hmm.
They're circulating globally.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the exact same thing, the local and the global, just like with the narrative structures.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's strange. I don't quite know where to really position him. I don't know whether you can say that it's Philippine cinema, to be honest.
Yeah. But there is a contradiction there. I mean, I'm a Malay filmmaker.
Yeah, of course.
How specific can you get? And at the same time, you know, there's this important presence of not only literature, but also modernist cinema in his work. He's a confessed fan of Tarkovsky, and he loves Sosio Sien's films. So that's maybe one more thing that before we turn it over to the audience, but to what extent is he upfront about influences? And not as much in terms of influence, but to what extent does he see himself as part of a tradition that is not only local? Let's say what's happening in the southeast of Asia with filmmakers like Abhishek Pong, you know, many other examples come to mind, but that have been hugely influenced by this Taiwanese New Wave films of Hosio Sien, primarily, that kind of offered the template for dealing with history, with memory, with national trauma. And of course, the histories of the Philippines and Taiwan are pretty similar in the sense that they, you know, they're a history of occupation, colonial history, their islands, you know, the Japanese occupation at a given point. So there are a lot of parallels there, and that's probably what Lav recognizes in House Films. But how important is that to him is what I would like to know.
He always says, you know, I just make cinema. That's it. You know, I don't make Philippine cinema, I just make cinema. It's just like, are your films slow or not? They're neither slow nor fast, they're cinema. But yeah, he if you ask him, you really need to ask him. He's not very open about, you know, I like this director, I was influenced by that director. You really need to open to ask him this question and really start digging. He's really not open about it. But one director who's for sure influenced him, apart from Andrei Tarkovsky, was Howe. He actually said that Howe's A Time to Live and A Time to Die really opened his eyes again about what film can do in terms of as a political tool.
Exactly.
You know, speaking about history and trauma.
Yeah. but also in an indirect way, because that was the criticism that was leveled at her when he made City of Sadness, that he was too elliptical about the way
the
violence was portrayed.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It was off screen.
Yeah.
And this is exactly what Lav is doing as well.
Yeah.
I think he has taken that perhaps from him, but Lav is not very direct about it.
Because you also get the same structure in storytelling. Like Ho in Lav's films, it takes quite a while before you get your bearing in these films.
Yep.
You see that, you enter into this world, you have these different long scenes, and you absorb atmosphere, and you absorb actions, but you don't really know what's going on, and only after a certain while are you given narrative context. And then what you've seen before becomes resonant again.
Yep.
Because of this context, and this is how Ho tells his stories, and this is something that we find
in. It happens a bit faster than
it happens a bit faster, yeah.
Yeah.
So what is that? This main radical gesture that he makes, making films that are virtually unreleasable because of their playing time. Why wager to such an extent on these films having such an impossible running time? Why not make 3-hour films in which the sense of duration is maybe as vivid, but why turn them into actual experiences like that? What's the importance?
He can make
of
short films as well.
Yeah.
He made an 8-minute short film.
Yeah.
He did. He was asked to make a 3-minute short film, but he just couldn't do it in 3.
Yeah.
So he made 8.
See?
we're still short film.
Yeah.
He really wants to bring home the idea of my life storytelling, and that these stories were really extremely long. And he also says that focusing on character psychology, focusing on all these aspects of trauma, for example, of history, of society, all these things take time. You cannot do it in 2 hours. I mean, you could, but the viewer doesn't get the same sense of it.
Mm.
So he really wants us to stay with the character, to really be with the character. And there was a guy after at the Lucan Film Festival, after the screening of From What Is Before, he went up to Lav Diaz, and I stood next to him, and he said, thank you very much. I felt as if I was taken on a journey for the Philippines, and I still have my rucksack on, and I would like to walk more.
Yeah.
And that's a very important part in Lav's filmmaking, that he really wants us to put on a rucksack and just walk with him. And just really experience it.
But he does want his films to be seen in a movie theater, not in a gallery or in a, whatever.
He says that you can watch my films wherever. Even on a long haul flight to America if you want.
Mm.
I mean, that's the perfect time for it. he says that you can watch his films wherever.
Yeah. We were talking about whether or not the filmmaker would be upset if, as you're watching these films, hopefully watching these wonderful, wonderful films.
No, you're forced to watch them.
Yeah, you're forced to watch them. But as you're watching these films, they're shown without breaks, except for the
Evolution.
Yep. The really long ones, you get a short break. But would the filmmaker get upset if you decided, after a certain moment, I've had enough at this point, I'm going to go for a walk and maybe come back after half an hour or an hour maybe?
For him, that's perfectly fine. That's part of the cinema experience. It's just like bringing your food, bringing your drinks, having a nap.
Yeah.
If you want to bring your pillow and have a nap after 4 hours, then please feel free to do that. Lav is really easygoing with that.
But then what about the narrative? Because stuff happens that's important, and structure.
Take,
and
if you take a 2 hours nap, then that may be difficult.
You're going to miss some things,
But if you just run to the loo, then that's fine, because the same take will still be there when you come back.
What's the longest take that he's ever done?
I think it's 50 minutes.
Yeah, 50 minute long
50, yes.
Yeah. And
he has book one. Look forward to it. It's somewhere in hour 7 or something.
Yeah.
It's incredible. He usually decides that, as far as I know, on the set, and he edits it already in the camera. That's why he likes digital cameras, because you can do everything in one go, basically. But other than that, it's really nothing special. The post editing, the post production is actually quite fast with him.
Mm-hmm.
That very much reminds me of Bellatar. I mean, he puts his films together in a week, just because, you know, it's just one take, and there's not much.
There are only four shots in the film.
Yeah, exactly. And you just put them together, and that's it. And I think Lav Diaz works pretty much the same if he is his own editor, and if he doesn't have a producer in the neck. It all changes when he's got a producer who obviously has his own agenda, which was the case with Naughty. And he said that in my interview. He wasn't quite happy with the color in Naughty,
mm-hmm.
because where they were shooting, it was just so colorful, and he thought that doesn't work well with the narrative.
Mm-hmm.
So he wanted to degrade the color,
mm-hmm.
and then it was black and white, and the producer said, no, we need to have color. So that really makes it difficult for editing. Then obviously it takes longer, there are more decisions. But other than that, if he's really just basically his own man...
Does he shoot in continuity in sequence?
I think so.
Mm, that would make sense for the actors, especially.
Yeah, yeah. And he doesn't rehearse, as far as I know. No, editing, I think, is pretty easy for his films.
Yeah.
Unless you do something like in Florentino with the sound. Then obviously it takes up a lot of work, because you need to decide about where to take away the sound.
And again, in terms of structures, the edit might be easy work, but the structure is really well thought of.
Yeah, of course.
For
Melancholia, for example, he shot the first part. And he thought that the film was finished, but actually, you know, the more he looked at the footage, the more he decided, no, I really need to add something.
Mm.
But he adds bit by bit as well. So that makes it really easy then in the end to just finish the film.
Mm. Do you think he's read Bazaar? He's probably read Bazaar, right?
Oh yeah, he has. He loves him.
Yeah.
He loves Bazin.
Because he's been compared to Rossellini, and with Rossellini again, there's this factor of the shot being, you know, an ethical choice almost.
Yeah. He's a very ethical director, I find.
Yeah.
There is this famous line, you know, every aesthetical choice is an ethical choice. And
mm-hmm.
I think that very much applies to Lav Diaz as well, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he said that, for example, for Encantos, he had so much footage of dead and bloated bodies,
mm.
and he just didn't want to show them, because he didn't want to be accused of being exploitative. He sees his filmmaking as an extension of what his parents have done, you know,
mm.
and that was teaching the poor.
Mm.
And I think he uses this duration that you're being with history, actually. You are not just with characters, you are also with history, you are with that country. That he's using that as teaching about the past.
Is there still a part of it that's just a provocation, in the sense of him placing himself resolutely outside of any industrial, commercial praxis, just by making these films impossible to release and, you know, self-distributed, etc., etc.? Is there that aspect to it? This kind of, you know, bad boy, anti-establishment?
We could certainly say so. We could read it like this. But once you meet him and talk to him, it's just, I mean, I've never met such a slow and zen person.
Yeah.
I think provocation was the last thing on his mind. At least he doesn't do it overtly.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he's doing what he's doing because he likes it, he finds it appropriate to the Malay philosophy,
mm-hmm.
as you wish, but he does not explicitly do it to provoke.
But it really comes back again to the question of, are we watching people or are we watching characters? And we were talking about this earlier as well. You know, the obvious comparison point, I guess, for the kind of epic length that he's using is Jacques Rivette and his Out One film that will be shown here in CINEMATEK. I don't know exactly when, but that's another, you know, important screening.
Mm-hmm.
I guess it's 13 hours long, and it, like, L'Amour Fou is... But of course, also what Rivette is looking at is performance as such. He likes to watch actors in training and see them come up with solutions to problems of staging and characterization, etc., etc. So the actor is, of course, vitally important to him, and I think the actor is vitally important to Lav Diaz, because if you're not going to get a decent at least a decent performance, then duration becomes just duration, and there is no real tension there.
Yep.
But if you're watching a character as convincingly played by an actor who's really into it and
they're
living their role, then it becomes fascinating.
I mean,
and it could go on for much longer.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, Hazel Orencio, that was, I mean,
incredible actress.
They both, I mean, Lav Diaz and Hazel Orencio, they both described the shooting as very traumatic for her, because she was so focused, she was in that personality.
Right.
But that's what made the performance so incredible.
It's an incredible feat of acting. If there's only one film that you see, it should
probably
be Florentina,
and
you will never forget her in that final scene, I think. I mean, in any other kind of more common art house type cinema, she would have gotten a zillion awards for that marvelous performance.
But it's the same in From What Is Before,
right.
the actress who plays the handicapped character, that's a performance.
Yeah.
Believe it or not, that's a performance.
Yeah.
And I mean, Lav Diaz was approached even by, you know, all kinds of doctors, and you know, and they said that is not played. She really is handicapped. And he said, no, she's a perfectly normal human being.
Yeah.
These incredible performances in all of his films.
Absolutely,
actually, it's not just Florentina. Or Hazel or Orencio. It's really difficult to say, you know, Florentina, is it Hazel, because they are so much into their role that they become the character.
Is there a kind of an ethical border for him there as well? Is there a certain... How far is he willing to go with an actor? I mean, in Florentina, there's also the given that her grandfather, so the grandfather of the girl is... It's raped. He's a real grandfather. I didn't know that, but in itself, that's a pretty strong decision to make, because this 70-year-old guy is sitting there in front of a shack where you know, in the story, his granddaughter is being raped. And how far is he willing to go with these actors in terms of immersion into their characters? And
it's not up to him. He leaves it up to the actor and actresses. If they're willing to play, then fine. If not, then he's looking for someone else.
Mm.
But usually he's, you know, all these actors and actresses are now so used to playing with that.
Mm.
But no, it's just, I mean, he says, look, that's what I want to show. I do not manipulate anything.
Mm-hmm.
And in interviews he also says, you know, the actors really have to be ready for it. And if they're not, then they're not the right actors for that.
Mm. But they're definitely not stars, although this one actress that he worked with in Century of Birthing, who's a model.
She didn't want to play the part any longer,
right.
And
yeah,
she was kind of popular,
So it does happen. Yeah.
It does happen, and in his new film, which he just finished, he's got two popular actors as well, which is a strange choice, but he now really starts to merge non-professional actors with professional actors.
Mm.
So we will see what the new film will be like.
Okay. So maybe one more thing about temporality and about duration, and how do you explain your choice for that kind of duration? Is there a danger that filmmakers, especially so-called third world country filmmakers, will find this to be the easiest idiom for them, because there's a lack of budget, there's a lack of technical capability in many cases, there's a lack of professional actors. So this becomes like the default choice, right? If you're a third world filmmaker, you have no money, you can still do long take cinema with non-professionals, and you know, you can do this stuff. Is there any risk, I mean, of this becoming almost a cliche of art house cinema?
Of course, but you can't say that it's a default choice, because you can't do these long takes with any non-professional mm-hmm. actor or actresses. You just can't.
Mm-hmm.
You nevertheless really need to have... I mean, most of the actors and actresses in Lav's films have a background in theatre.
Yeah.
So that's helpful. So they're not completely unprofessional.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that you can't say I use duration just because I don't have professional actors. That doesn't work.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that's right because you still need an expressive character.
Mm-hmm.
You still need that. Someone who really needs to live the role he's ascribed to.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise the whole film just doesn't work. As for funding usually comes from abroad. His last film and Locarno winner from what is before was, I think, one of the first films that received funding from the Philippines, that came from the Philippine Development Council. Other than that, he does not receive money from his own country. It's usually the Hubert Bals Fund from Rotterdam, for example, all kinds of other small organizations where he gets the money from, or he collects money even amongst friends. So it's really very basic. He did not get rid of the script entirely. Maybe I didn't make that clear. He does write a script, but he writes that at night. In the morning they print it off, the actors just read it, and then they start shooting it. But he writes it on the go. He does not write a whole script for an 8-hour film and then starts shooting, but he writes it on the go. They go to the location, and then even he needs to be in that location,
right, exactly.
In order to write the script.
Yeah.
And then he needs to, say, shoot 2 or 3 scenes in order to get the new ideas.
Right.
That's exactly how he's doing it. And that's why I think he says that his filmmaking is organic, because
yeah.
he really just sits in that location and waits for the ideas to come.
Right.
Most of the time, when he's out shooting, they're not really shooting. He's waiting for ideas. That's how he's working. He's sitting and waiting for ideas.
And that type of filmmaking, you can do that, because
yeah, of course.
Any kind
of course,
commercial
yeah.
filmmaking, it's
yeah.
impossible to do.
Yeah.
But still, I guess we should distinguish between, you know, having no script from having no preparation. There is no finished script, and the script is informed, you know, the way the story develops is informed by the people and the environment and the locations and everything.
The script isn't final anyway.
No, it's not final, but there's a very strong conception about what the film is going to be. Yeah. And
it's a very basic thing in what the actors are doing with it.
Right. The same thing with Rossellini, when he went out to shoot, say, Viaggio in Italia, he didn't have a script for the actors that drove the actors completely nuts, but he had a very strong idea about the type of film that he wanted to make. Originally wanted to do an adaptation of James Joyce's The Dead, so there was again this literary background that he had
yeah.
in his mind, the type of story that he wanted to do. And for some kind of reason, those filmmakers, I don't know if this is pure luck or maybe it's forced luck, but it's they're the most fortuitous people on earth, because you know whatever should happen to have them find their film actually does happen. Imagine Viaggio in Italia without the Pompeii sequences, without this central emblem or allegory of the film, these two lovers, you know, that were
yeah.
found, you know, cast in underneath the rubble of Pompeii, this couple that they discovered, man and a woman, entangled. And that's, of course, the image for a film about an alienated couple. And if that didn't happen during the location work, etc., then, you know, he would have had a really hard time tying his film together because he didn't know where it was going to bring him. And I guess Diaz works in, you know, something along the same lines. General idea and general starting point, and then hopefully he will find something
yeah.
that will bring it all together.
So sometimes he even goes to the location with actors and actresses without
mm.
any plan whatsoever. I mean, he tells his actors that he's got a plan, but actually he doesn't.
Yeah.
That was the case with Melancholia. He had a completely different film in mind, and they went to the location, and he just bent the script. He just
yeah.
reversed it.
So he just tells them, you're a nun, and you're going to walk down the street.
Yep. But it's also, he works very much like Tarkovsky in that sense, because mm-hmm. I know that for, was it The Mirror, I think, where mm-hmm. the actors and actresses did not know the ending of the film, and that obviously helps for the character, well, for them to be the characters in that scene. They do not mm-hmm. work towards a goal, they're mm-hmm. just there in the present. Mm-hmm. And when you're not having a full script from finish to end, the actors don't know it either, so they're just mm-hmm. there, they really just are. Mm-hmm. That's it, and they're in the present.
Is there a lot of improvisation? Sorry, that's a difficult
word.
Yes,
there is. There is, yeah.
Also, I mean, in terms of lines and dialogue? And
yes, because yeah. in these long takes, you cannot remember all the dialogue, especially all this philosophical talk, mm-hmm. especially in Notte. Mm-hmm. These lengthy scenes, no, it has to be improvised. I mean, yeah. That's what Diaz is essentially writing. He's writing a very, very basic script. Yeah. And then says, you know, whatever comes into your head, bring it in.
But how does that happen then? Is that based on conversations that these people were actually having, like Lav Diaz and his friends, the actors, they sit together, they talk about the themes of the story, etc. And, I don't know, a reference to Heidegger or Nietzsche comes up, or to Dostoevsky, and it becomes part of the script, and he writes, you know, dialogue in which these references occur. How does he make up these scenes?
Either that, or it really just pops up in conversation in front of the character by pure luck.
Yeah.
It's just because it pops into an actor's head.
Yeah.
It's both. It's completely unpredictable, his filmmaking. You cannot say he always does that or he always does that. It's just for some films he has written the script with Heidegger and stuff.
Yeah.
And in other films it's just complete improvisation.
Were there instances where nothing happened? Where we were just waiting for something to happen and nothing happened and the film was completely stuck?
No.
Ah.
No.
How lucky must these filmmakers be that something always happens? The exact thing that they need. Anyway. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Go and see the Lav Diaz films.
Yeah, at least Florentina, please.
At least Florentina. If there's one film that you do see,
then it's Florentina.
Let it be Florentina or Melancholia, I guess.
The Melancholia,
yeah.
Yes.
So.
But do see as many films as you can, please.
Absolutely.
Because it's really worth it. It really, really is worth it.
Yeah. So.